Thank you so much for having me. Although I have to say I did not like the shout out to my age. It's a new thing, not a fan. All right, guys, you having a good weekend? Did you have a good conference? All right, good. Good, good. All right, my name is Liz Wheeler. I host the show Tipping Point on One American News Network. I hope that you have seen it before. This, however, is one of my favorite things to do, to come up here to the Reagan Center and talk to y'all, because you guys listen and you care about what our country stands for enough to show up here and fight for it. So even though you've spent the whole weekend listening to other people talk and listening to what other people say, I want you to know that we all care about what you have to say and we care about what you think of our country. So thank you for that. Okay, you could have clapped there for yourselves, but that's okay. Okay, so today we're gonna talk about climate change. Climate change. Did you guys see that video that went around on Twitter of the guy twerking at the climate strike? Did you see that? Yeah, unfortunately, we all did. Twerking and booty dropping while someone threw glitter on him to save the planet, dropping into the splits. I heard, actually, that the reason that he did that, it's a rather unorthodox way to fight climate change. I heard that he did that because somebody told him that politicians weren't twerking hard enough to find a fix to climate change. My sister is 16, told me not to make that joke because it's embarrassing, but I thought it was funny. Okay, so I'm here today to deliver a hard truth to that man and to many other people. Twerking will not solve climate change. In fact, I'm here today to talk about Greta Thunberg and a whole generation of kids, your generation of Americans, who have been told lies about climate change. So first of all, what I want to do is, how many of you in this room, by a show of hands, how many of you believe in climate change? So that's a trick question. That's a trick question. This is a question that the left uses as a rhetorical trick. We've talked about this before, so anybody who's been to one of these YAF conferences might recognize this. It is called the binary choice tactic. Do y'all remember hearing about that? The binary choice tactic is a trick that the left uses. They ask you a question in a way that gives you only two options. Option number one is you adhere to their radical leftist ideology, meaning you agree with them, or the only alternative is that you're a bad person. They don't want to give you any other options, just that binary choice tactic. Either you agree with them or you're a bad person. In this case, that question, do you believe in climate change, is a binary choice question, because they want you to either agree with their solution, their political solution to climate change, or they want to paint you as a science denier. So when they talk about climate change, don't mistake it for the fluctuating temperatures. They're talking about their Green New Deal political version of climate change. Okay, so I'm here to tell you today, you don't have to choose one of those two binary options. You could acknowledge a problem with polluting in our oceans. Plastic in our ocean is a problem. You don't have to deny that. You can advocate for responsible deforestation. You can support market-driven innovation for renewable energy, and you can acknowledge the historical trends of fluctuating temperatures. You can also advocate for responsible stewardship of God's creation, all without buying into the liberal climate twerking crap. So today, I want to give you 10 reasons not to believe the climate change criers, because at least for me, when you hear these talking points or these narratives that come from the left about the climate, it's not the easiest topic to debunk, because a lot of times they hide it either in rhetorical tricks like the binary choice tactic, or they hide it in pseudoscientific facts that you might not know how to debunk off the top of your head. So what I want to do today is I want to give you 10 reasons not to believe what they say, or 10 reasons to question what they say. The number one reason not to believe what these doomsdayers say is because their predictions never come true. They tell us that if we don't do something, if we don't pass the Green New Deal, that our Earth is going to die in 12 years. Life will cease to exist as we know it. But they've been saying this for 40 years. They've been making these doomsday predictions since before you and I were born. In fact, they predicted by the year 2000 that all the polar ice caps would be melted, and they're not. They predicted that 50 million climate refugees from Pacific islands would be flooding the West by now, and they're not. These same people, and I'm not just talking about politicians, these are scientists from NASA, from NOAA, these are scientists from the United Nations, these are high-level people in this movement. They've predicted that California would be flooded with inland seas by now. You guys can check what you're sitting on right now, but I'm pretty sure you're sitting on chairs, you're not sitting in rowboats. So that is another prediction that hasn't come true, and you can go on and on. They said the Netherlands would be uninhabitable by now. They said the Himalayan glaciers would be on the road to being fully melted. They said the Arctic would no longer enjoy ice. Children wouldn't know what snow is. These are all predictions made by climate change scientists, propagated by reputable or formerly reputable news networks, and none of these predictions came true. So now we're told, well, no matter about that, no matter that the credibility of these doomsday sayers, these predictors, no matter that, we should listen to them when they predict that our world is going to end in 12 years now. And my question is, if they've gotten every single thing wrong in the past, why would we believe them now? So that's reason number one. And it actually brings us to reason number two, why you shouldn't believe climate change criers. They have a rule. No questions allowed. You're not allowed to ask what I just asked. You're not allowed to say, well, how come this prediction is accurate if none of your other predictions have ever been accurate? You're not allowed to question Al Gore or AOC or Greta Thunberg. Not at all. You have to believe and not ask questions. And that brings us to the third reason why you shouldn't believe climate change deniers, because they try to destroy skeptics. They don't just not want you to ask questions. If you do ask questions, they try to destroy you. And this is how we know that it's not based on science, because everyone's taken a basic biology class, right? Everyone's taken a basic science class, and you know that the basis of science, the scientific method, is based on skepticism. You ask questions. Something's not a scientific fact or a scientific law unless it can't be disproven. If it can't be disproven, then you know a whole lot of people have tried to prove it wrong. Those people were skeptics. But in the climate change world, you're not allowed to do that, which means it's not really based on science. The other part of this, the other part of the destruction of climate skeptics, is they tell you that 97% of climate change scientists are in consensus, right? You guys have heard that statistic, right? The majority, the consensus, 97% of scientists agree. So there's a couple reasons why that's wrong. First of all, consensus does not equal being right. At one point in history, the greatest scientific minds were in consensus that the Earth was flat. That wasn't right, but they all agreed on it. So consensus does not equal something being right. And then the factoid about 97% of scientists agree. Do you know how that statistic came to be? Do you know what that's based on? No, you probably don't. Not very many people do. And not very many people ask, what is that based on? So I'm going to tell you, it's based on a group of citizen scientists. They did a study. Do you know what a citizen scientist is? An activist who doesn't want to seem political. Citizen scientists, it's a group of activists who got together and they claimed that they analyzed over 11,900 scientific papers on climate change, on the human contribution to climate change. And they analyzed these papers and came to the conclusion that 97% of the scientists who published these papers were in agreement. But do you know how they analyzed these papers? They did a Google search within this scientific database just for the words climate change and human-involved climate change. And then they didn't read what the viewpoint of the scientist was. They just assumed that those words meant that that scientist agreed that humans are the largest contributing factor to climate change. And so they published this statistic, which has become one of the most commonly repeated statistics about climate change, and it's simply not true. a group of actual scientists got together and analyzed those 11,944 papers. And do you want to know what percent of those papers actually support the original contention that humans were the majority driving factor behind climate change? Not 97%, 0.3%. But you won't hear that. You don't hear that because the climate change criers don't want to talk about it. They don't want to answer your questions, and maybe it's easy to see why. Because when you do ask the questions, you find fatal flaws. So that brings us to reason number four why you shouldn't believe the climate criers. When there is something that they get wrong, when there is science that's not really science, it's pseudoscience, when they make a mistake that impacts a large prediction, they cover it up. Do you guys know what NOAA is? The National Oceanic? Oh yeah, go ahead. Okay, NOAA is the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Association. It's a government-funded agency. It's basically government-funded meteorology and climate studies, okay? NOAA, a government agency, is known, they're known within the scientific community for fudging numbers. And I want to give you an example of this. In 2016, NOAA claimed that year, 2016, was one of the hottest years on record. You've heard that claim, I'm sure, right? That we're experiencing the hottest years on record? That's not true. It's not true at all. In fact, 2016, the percentage of hot days in 2016 was below average. Do you know what it ranked? 80th since 1985. The percentage of hot days in the year 2016 was only 80th on the list of the years with the highest number of hot days since 1895. And they cover this up. They make this claim and they cover up the real data. How do they cover it up? Well, they adjusted their own reporting. They didn't use actual numbers, they used conjecture, not actual data that they collected. They adjusted their reported temperature to match almost identically with CO2 in the atmosphere. So it wasn't based on numbers that they'd measured and then transcribed and then put into a graph and then analyzed to see if it was the hottest day. They made it up. They made it up to match their political agenda. So in other words, maybe they don't know what they're talking about when it comes to the data. And if they don't know what they're talking about when it comes to the data, then who are they to make these claims, these prophecies, and then to give these prophecies to politicians who want to convert that into political policy? And so that brings us to the fifth reason not to believe the climate change criers. The fifth reason has to do with the politicians here. The politicians don't even know what they believe exactly. And we're going to use AOC as an example here. AOC, you've heard her say this, I'm sure. AOC has said we only have 12 years left until we're past the point of no return if we don't do something. Have you guys heard her say that? Okay, so that's very strange then, that after she said that in a very serious way, that she then tweeted, and this is a quote here, "You would have to have the social intelligence of a sea sponge to think that that claim is literal." But when she said it, it sounded literal. But she says when the GOP makes fun of her, quote, "The GOP is basically Dwight from The Office, so who knows?" Well, is the claim real or is the claim not real? Because if it's not literal, then that would change how we reacted to it, wouldn't it? The politicians don't know the truth either. So that brings us to reason number six, you shouldn't believe the climate criers because of the people who they make their spokespeople. They hide behind a child. Did you guys see the video of Greta Thunberg? How dare you? You've stolen my dreams, my childhood, you saw that? Well, here's the conundrum. And I'm not here to make fun of her as a person. I feel bad for her because I think she's being exploited. But here's the conundrum. If Democrats tell us that we can't have an opinion on climate change because we're not the scientists, and the scientists are all in consensus, if we're not allowed to talk about climate change because we're not scientists, how come their primary spokesperson on the international stage is not a scientist but a 16-year-old child? Do you guys know the answer to that? Because they use the child as a rhetorical human shield. They conflate bullying of a child and criticism of the political ideology she's espousing. So if you criticize what she says, if you criticize the fact that she wants to cut fossil fuel use and carbon emissions in half or more, then you're bullying a child. That's what the left will tell you. And so they exploit children. They use children as spokespeople so that they can accuse anybody who asks a question of being mean to that child. You should immediately be skeptical of any political organization whose primary spokesperson is a child. And that brings us to the other leaders of this movement, AOC and Al Gore. Did I mention the financial benefit to these leaders? The hypocrisy here. Al Gore, the benefits that he has enjoyed on his global doomsday tours, his million-dollar homes, his fleet of gas-guzzling SUVs, these apparently, for you and me, these are climate sins. But for the leaders of this movement, the people who are telling us that we should sacrifice our freedom to the government so that the government can fix this problem, it's okay if they commit these same climate sins. That should immediately make you skeptical as well. But that's part of the problem, and this is reason number 8 not to believe the climate change criers. They tell us that only government, not individuals, not the free market, only government can fix the problem. Can anybody here name one problem that only government can fix? Is there anything the government has done that they have done better than the private sector ever in the course of the history of our country? I can't think of a single thing. Not one single thing. So why would we trust government to this? Why would we trust this to government? Because this is part of their plan. This is part of what they want from climate change. They're using climate change as a medium to get to their political goal. And that brings me, that brings me to reason number 9. Did you ever notice that all of the solutions to climate change, all of the ways that we have to act, the do somethings that we have to do conveniently, are all political policies that the left has wanted for many, many years? And I'm not talking about just policies that address climate change. I'm talking about what you see when you open up the Green New Deal. What do you see? Government-run healthcare. That's what you see. Universal basic income. That's what you see. Minimum wage hikes. That's what you see. Penalties, if not a ban, on eating meat and traveling by airplane. These are all things. Higher taxes, job guarantees. What on earth do those things have to do with climate change and fluctuating temperatures? It's very, very convenient. If you look at the solutions to climate change, it's very convenient that all of the solutions the Democrats want politically are political policies that they have wanted for a very long time. And that brings us to reason number 10, to be skeptical of the climate change criers. What would happen in our nation if we accepted their premise? What would our country look like 10 years down the road if we said, okay, we believe your premise, we believe that the world will end in 12 years if we don't pass the Green New Deal, and therefore we agree to pass the Green New Deal. What would happen in our nation? It's not rhetorical. Shout it out. What would happen? Poverty. Socialism. Doom. Whoever said doom? That's a great word. The Democrats want a carbon-neutral society. They want to eliminate all fossil fuels. They want to ban nuclear power, too, which would leave us entirely dependent on wind and solar power. But without backup generators relying on fossil fuels or nuclear power, what happens if it's not windy or it's not sunny? What happens to the people who depend on electricity, not just in their day-to-day life for convenience, but what happens to hospitals? What happens when we're not able to rely on wind power or solar power? The same with electric cars. Electric cars require the mining of elements from sweet mama Earth. And somehow the Democrats bypass that and don't care about that when they're advocating for us to give up our cars and only take mass transportation. And this is where it betrays itself. It betrays itself and becomes more like a cult than a science. If all of the climate hysteria is in the interest of saving the people by saving the planet, then how come the so-called solution to all of this is socialism? Because we know what happens to countries that implement socialism, don't we? We don't even have to look to history. We don't have to look to Cuba and their communism. We don't have to look to the Soviet Union. We can look at Venezuela right now. We know what happens when a nation is socialist. We've seen this throughout history. So if the left actually cared about humankind, mankind, why would their solution entail imposing the suffering of socialism on hundreds of millions of people? That should be the question that we ask these people. Because make no mistake, that's what would happen. They tell us, Greta Thunberg tells us, that we are on the precipice of a mass starvation event. But that's what would happen, too, if we implemented the Green New Deal. If we allowed socialism to encroach on our nation, we would see that same poverty, that same destitution, that same oppression that would lead to mass starvation. And I'm not being hyperbolic here, because we can look in history and we can see that happening down in Venezuela. We've seen the videos of people in the Soviet Union eating shoes because they could not get a loaf of bread. We've seen this happen here before. And if you look at the Green New Deal, if you look at Greta Thunberg's plan, you can open it up and you'll find that that's what it is. It's socialism in the name of saving the planet from climate change. So then we get to the political aspect of this. We ask ourselves, why have they staged this elaborate lie? If that's what this is, if we're able to go through the narrative on climate change and debunk it, as we've done in short form tonight, why stage this elaborate lie? And the answer to this is because only a tiny, marginal fraction of Americans want socialism in our nation. But the Democrats, the elected officials, the politicians, they want socialism. So they stage this lie to serve as a conduit to usher socialism into America without the voters' consent. And they do this through this process. They fearmonger first. They tell us that young people won't be able to have children because our children will have no future. They tell us the world is going to end. They create this fear in us because fear creates urgency. It makes us want to act. Once people are scared and believe the warning, they want to act. And then they tell us the private sector has had 30, 40, 50 years, maybe even 100 years to solve this problem. And the private sector, they tell us, has failed. So the only option is for us to turn to the government. Only government can fix the problem. And once the people believe this, because we've been indoctrinated, feel the fear, because we want to be able to have children and we don't want the world to end, once we feel that urgency to do something, and once we've been convinced that the only way that we can fix this is through the government because the private sector has failed, then Democrats give us Greta Thunberg and AOC and Al Gore. They give us a bill like the Green New Deal, and they say it fights climate change, but it actually ushers in communism. And so I'm here to tell you, your generation specifically today, do not fall for this. Do not fall for this. All of this is based on a doctrine contradicted by both science and history, invented out of thin air as a method to control behavior, coming at you in the form of a Green New Deal that regulates your behavior, your choices, and your life on everything, from using plastic straws, to eating cheeseburgers, to buying an airline ticket to visit your family or come to this conference, forcing you and your parents to tear down your house, give your money to other people, and fundamentally undermining the economy in our nation to the point where you won't even be allowed to own a car anymore, and the government will own everything and control everyone. And you and I will be left without the basic modern necessities to survive and thrive in America. If that sounds scary, it's because it is scary. It's not something we can't fight against, but it's not something that we can pretend is real and go along with, because this is a strategy the Democrats have been putting into play for years and years, and it is only now, forgive the pun, coming to a tipping point, and it's up to our generation to stop it. And now you know the 10 reasons, main reasons, why it's a scam. Thank you. Do you guys want to do questions? Yeah?
Students, go ahead and line up in the back to ask Liz a question. We'll start with a question from one of our virtual past participants. Dominic from Georgia asks, your book was really successful and you were a first-time author. What tips do you have for other aspiring authors to succeed like you have?
First of all, thank you, Dominic, for asking the question via the virtual pass. Thank you, everyone that's tuned in online to watch this. Hi, Mom. I think the best tip that I have is know what you want to communicate to somebody. Because if you don't know what you want to communicate, if you don't know your arguments, then you're going to have an awfully hard time writing 70,000 words on that topic. So know what you want to communicate first for the writing of the book. And then for the marketing of the book, I mean, it really helps to have a TV show to help market that. But build up your social media, network as often as you can, and write something good so that it spreads by word of mouth. That's my best advice.
Hi, I'm Drew Fatter from Classical Academy High School, and I was just asking if you could repeat the 10 statements you made about climate change.
Absolutely not, but you can watch it online again.
Okay.
I'll give you my notes after if you want them.
Okay, that's cool. Thank you.
Of course. You don't have to clap for that one.
Hi, my name is Leah. I'm from Florida. I go to Franklin Academy, and my question is, yesterday in a meeting of AOC, a girl said that we are polluting because there are too many people and we need to eat our babies. This is is this emotional cycle, rhetorica, or lack of true facts?
That was a plant. It wasn't a real thing. It was a troll. It was someone who does not agree with AOC, who is trying to trick AOC into saying something stupid. And don't get me wrong, I think many, many things that AOC says are stupid, but I actually thought she handled that totally fine because the person was not real. I mean, like, the person was real, but what she was saying, she was trying to cause a scene so that she could get a video to go viral. So it wasn't a real proposal.
Okay, thank you.
Of course.
Hi, Liz.
Hi, good to see you again.
Thanks. I'm Cameron Arcan from Northwood High School, and the other day I was in a conversation with my friend about climate change, and they were, I brought up the fact how the United States is actually number one in reducing carbon emissions and has some of the top air quality in the world, yet without the Paris Climate Accord, yet they were still saying, oh, but the Democrats are the only ones proposing solutions right now to help solve like certain pollution issues. What's your response to that?
To ask them what solutions the Democrats are proposing.
Okay.
Because the solutions the Democrats are proposing, it's the Green New Deal, right?
Mm-hmm.
How does that help?
Exactly.
One of the things that I always tell people is when you're in a debate, whether this is on television, whether it's in a situation like this, whether it's talking to your family or a friend at school, is to always ask questions back. Not necessarily a complicated question, but just a simple question. Say, well, what solutions are Democrats proposing? And then if they can't name it, then you're good right there. If they name something like the Green New Deal or like cutting back on carbon emissions, then you say, okay, well, what's the unintended consequence of the policy? Because the intended consequence might be to cut back on carbon emissions, but what's the unintended consequence of the policy? Because we know if we cut back on, you know, fossil fuel use, if we eliminate, prohibit fossil fuels, then everything that I went through in my speech would happen. We'd have to rely on wind and solar without backup generators, without nuclear energy, and that would cause a lot of people destitution, if not death. So you have to weigh the two. Does the benefit outweigh the disadvantage or the risk of it? And nothing that I'm aware of that the Democrats are proposing, does the benefit outweigh the damage that it would cause to our nation?
All right, great. Thank you.
Of course.
Hi, I'm Carly Steele from Oregon Connections Hi. Academy. And in Oregon, everyone pretty much considers themselves to be a climate change activist. And I was wondering what your suggestion would be to kind of build a platform to expose the left's fear-mongering tactics and start teaching people the truth.
Well, I would do the same thing that I just recommended to Cameron, and I would ask questions. So I would start by acknowledging that there are things that we can do to improve how we take care of our planet. The left likes to pretend that all Republicans and all conservatives want to just trash the earth. I've actually never met a Republican and a conservative, or a conservative, and I run in these circles a lot, who doesn't care about the earth. We all care about the earth. We just have differing ideas on how we think it's best to take care of it. So I'd start by reiterating that, you know, we want to reduce the plastic in the ocean. We want to be responsible about our deforestation. We actually support market-driven innovation of renewable energy. What we don't support is government taking over and imposing all of these policies on the American people. So I'd start by finding common ground with them. Once you've found common ground, then you can kind of ask the questions and say, well, what's your solution to this? Why do you think that causing America to, you know, eliminate fossil fuels, why do you think that would make a difference in the global temperature if China and India, the Asian countries, are primarily responsible for the global emissions or for the damage that's been done to our planet? Because there's an argument to be made that even if we implemented entirely the Green New Deal, that it wouldn't have an impact on this temperature that we're told is rising at a detrimental level, because we're not even kind of close to the worst offenders. So that's where I would start.
Thank you.
Of course.
Hi, my name is Olivia. I go to Central High School in Springfield, Missouri. And I was just wondering, nuclear energy seems like a really effective solution to the problems that the Democrats are saying that we're kind of facing right now. And I'm just curious as to why no one's talking about this.
Well, no one's talking about it because there's a divide among the Democrat 2020 presidential candidates whether we should ban it or not. And God forbid they actually debate during this primary. They don't want to point up anything bad about each other. So I think that there's three or four of them who want to ban nuclear energy entirely, which is beyond ridiculous. But no one really talks about that too much because talking about that on a national level would require that both Democrats and the media ask those questions and investigate that, and they won't because of the rule about not asking questions. But we should bring it up at every chance that we get, because it's untenable to think that we would have enough energy to operate our country in the way that we do without fossil fuels and without nuclear energy. It simply would not work. And I doubt that there's a scientist, even one that believes in climate change, I doubt there's a scientist that would even contend that we'd be able to keep living the way that we're living without one or the other.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Trinity from Pennsylvania. First of all, I'm a huge fan.
Thank you.
You're welcome. My question is, do you have any tips for like having arguments and facts on you like right away? Because you never know when you're going to be in a debate with somebody.
Sure. Do you have a specific topic?
Climate change.
Okay, that makes sense. I always go directly to the questions. Did you get a copy of my book today? There's a whole chapter in my book about how to debate the left. I give 11 tactics, and you can apply this to any topic. It doesn't have to be climate change. It can be abortion. It can be the economy. It can be minimum wage. It can be whatever you want it to be. They're tactics, practical rhetorical tricks, essentially, that you can use in a debate that always brings the debate back to what I call the heart of the matter. So when we're talking about any topic, there's a million different tangents that flow off that topic, right? But we want to be able to identify as conservatives what the heart of the matter is. So for climate change, for example, the heart of the matter is that Democrats' solution to it is socialism, right? And we don't want to get into the weeds on the other parts of that topic, because the debate between conservatives and Democrats is that they want socialism to solve the problem and we don't. So I'd encourage you, at the risk of sounding like I'm promoting my own book, to read that chapter in my book, because I lay out exactly what you can do, because I think a lot of people ask that same question. One of the tactics that I encourage is asking those questions up front and not doing a data dump of everything you know. Asking a question to lead the conversation where you want it to go. Another tactic that I say, or that I recommend, is letting the other person get all of their points across before you interrupt them. Because once they've kind of run out of BS, they'll be able to listen to you better, and they won't just respond with their stock talking points. So for example, if they had 6 points they want to make and you interrupt them after point two, it doesn't really matter what you say. They're still going to respond to you with their third point, even if it's not relevant to what you said. So if you let them, if you kind of play psychologist for a second and let them, you know, run out of things to say, then they might actually have to address the point that you made. And that's just two of the examples of the 11 in my book, but I think it'll be helpful.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Of course.
Hi, I'm Gwen McDowell. I'm homeschooled with Seton Home Study School. And
I was homeschooled too.
Throughout this week, we've had speakers that are talking about the evils of socialism. And I was wondering, what are things we can do to get rid of socialism?
To get rid of socialism in other countries or to prevent it from taking root here?
Too.
Well, I think exposing what it is, meaning so often the Democrats talk about democratic socialism, right? And they deny that democratic socialism is the same socialism of Venezuela or Cuba or the Soviet Union. So the first thing that we have to do is we have to force them to define what they mean. We have to say, what is democratic socialism? What does that mean to you? How does that translate into political policies? Because once we force them to define what it is, then we're able to see that democratic socialism is just the same as regular old socialism. Regular old socialism we know leads on a path to destruction, like all of the examples that we've talked about several times today already. So the first step is making sure that people know what it is. Make sure that they don't listen to Bernie Sanders, hear him say socialism, and think, oh, fairness, higher wages, jobs for everyone, healthcare for everyone. We have to define what socialism is, that it's government control of the means of production and distribution, which means that you as a citizen don't have the liberty to make choices about your own life. And then once you define it, you can say what that ultimately leads to, because we're very unique and we're very special in the United States, but we are not the first people in history, and we are not the first people to try stupid political ideas in history. And so we have to learn from the mistakes of the people before us. And once we define it and unpack it and apply that to history, I think a lot of people are gonna back away from what they thought at first was appealing.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Silas Paul. I am homeschooled from North Idaho. So I just had a question about something you said in your last lecture. You said that you can't think of anything that the government can do better than private citizens.
Yeah, did you think of something?
Oh, well, I was just wondering, if you believe in any need for government.
Well, of course there's a need for government, but when we're talking about industries or social problems, there's not anything that government has proved that they have done better, meaning they're not better at innovators than the free market. They're not better at overseeing healthcare than the free market. They're not better than the individual in running businesses. Every industry-related thing has always been done better by a free market than by government. The role of government, there's certainly a role for government. I mean, it's laid out very clearly in our founding documents, but the role of government is to make sure that the people's inherent rights are not infringed by enemies, foreign or domestic, meaning anybody who wishes to kill us outside of our country or politicians who wish to violate our freedoms inside our country. That's essentially the role of a federal government. Only I think the Declaration of Independence says governments established among men by the consent of the governed, and that they're established, not quoting anymore, they're established for the sole purpose of protection. They're not established to take care of us. And so that's their role. I don't know how that would apply to, can they do anything better than we can do it ourselves, because we are the government in that sense, collectively, when we're defending our own rights.
Thank you.
Does that answer your question?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Jack Roper. I am homeschooled, but I take a lot of my classes at a junior college in San Diego.
Oh, good for you.
So there's a place, are you familiar with Cabrillo?
Yes.
So there's a point in San Diego where he's thought to have landed. And a couple of years ago when I visited there, there was a sign that was saying that it should be underwater by 2020 or 2025. Recently, the water level actually went down from what it was.
Oh, shocker.
Obviously, it's not going to be that high by next year. So what I'm wondering is, how can we make sure that signs and things like that are actually truthful?
Well, I mean, you can't force someone not to lie, but you can debunk them when they do lie. And I mean, I think that's what I try to do. I think that's what a lot of you guys are interested in doing as well, is learning the truth, so that when scientists or media figures or politicians tell us things that aren't true, we're educated enough so that we can say, well, wait a second. How can that be true if, you know, XYZ is also true? So I don't know that we can force someone to be honest, but we can certainly debunk them. We can also encourage conservative people to get involved in disciplines and industries that are dominated by the left, because the more dissenters and skeptics and independent thinkers that are in science, the less they're going to be able to be involved in that protectionist groupthink that allows them to fudge numbers and lie and make predictions without accountability. But the primary way that I do that is I try to learn the truth about each topic so that I can say, I see your argument and I raise you the truth, because then they don't have a response for it. The more people that hear the truth and hear the narrative being debunked, the less the lying people are going to be believed.
Thank you.
Of course.
We have another virtual pass question. Paloma from Auburn, Alabama asks, why is the left so much more effective than conservatives at reaching young people? Is attracting young people even an attainable goal for conservatives?
Good questions. First of all, of course, attracting young people is an attainable goal. Look at all the young people here. They're all conservatives, right? Yeah, of course. Of course it's attainable. Of course it's attainable. The left is better at communicating to young people because Republicans in general tend to be a little on the wonky side, maybe not always a little more studious, a little bit less cool sometimes. And so liberals beat them out in the communication game because liberals meet young people at their level, meaning liberals will use the emotional argument and sort of exploit young people, saying, oh, if you care about this, then you better believe in my liberal ideology. And they appeal to that emotion. Republicans are more intellectually honest and don't always engage in that kind of emotional manipulation. Unfortunately, that type of communication works a lot of times on young people. The other reason that the left is more effective at recruiting young people is our education system. And I'm not just talking about colleges. You guys see this in your high schools, I'm sure. This is actually as low as a lot of elementary schools. We see revisionist history. We see political correctness. There was a sixth grader in my home state of Ohio who was sent to the principal's office because he politely declined to call a transgender classmate by the preferred pronoun that did not match the classmate's biology, birth gender. The principal told him he would be suspended if he didn't stop that bullying. That's not bullying, that's science. As long as it's done in a kind way, a compassionate way towards that individual. But that kind of indoctrination is in a lot of schools from a very young age, and so young people are primed by the time they get to the university level to believe a lot of the liberal crap that's taught in universities because they've been indoctrinated since kindergarten. I mean, right here in California, there's a sex ed curriculum that they're trying to implement in California public schools that would teach kindergartners, these are five-year-olds, that they can be transgender if they want to be. This is taught to children at a very young age, and the left has been very, very effective at infiltrating our public school system. And so they win a lot of young people, at least at first, until young people realize that they have been lied to. So that's the answer to the question. Thank you on the virtual pass for asking.